do not track legislation. The proposed law would establish a protocol that allows Internet users to opt out of having their online activity tracked by data-gathering companies. This House Energy and Commerce hearing is 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Good morning to all who are gathered here. And we want to convene this hearing on the Subcommittee on Commerce, Trade, and Consumer Protection. So the hearing is now called to order. And we will begin with opening statements with a few announcements by the chair. There are approximately 5 votes that are currently occurring on the floor. So at this time, we will have the opening statements from the chair and from the ranking member. At the conclusion of those opening statements, we will recess and go and vote. And we will reconvene probably close to around the noon hour. And then we will leave the, we will allow members on both sides to continue the opening statements for half an hour. So upon reconvening, the members will be given an additional half an hour for their opening statements. And the purpose of that is to allow members to deliver the opening statements, but also to do it within a certain specified time span so that we won't have stragglers coming in and keeping the opening statements, keeping this phase, prolonging this phase. So that is how we will operate this morning.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, some of us have conflicting committee members. Would this be an appropriate time to ask for unanimous consent that all members of the committee might have 5 legislative days within which to submit a statement for the record?
I would think so. If there's no objection, hearing no objection, so ordered.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The chair recognizes himself for 5 minutes for the purposes of opening statement. Good morning. We are pleased to welcome into our midst today 7 witnesses. They have graciously offered to share their views with this subcommittee about the feasibility of a legislative do not track mechanism and how technological solutions to privacy perils and pitfalls could augment a comprehensive national privacy framework. Through such a mechanism, consumers could advise would-be trackers unambiguously and persistently that they do not wish to be followed by digital snoopers and spies across websites and their various fixed and mobile computing devices. More than 2 years ago, I heard testimony as chairman of this very same subcommittee from Ms. Lois Gresham, the FTC's Associate Director of Division of the Marketing Practices. And Mrs. Gresham spoke about the FTC's successes in rooting out deceptive and abusive telemarketing acts and practices through the Do Not Call registry. From fiscal years 2003 through 2007, more than 145 million telephone numbers had been entered into the Do Not Call registry. Over the same period, approximately $80 million in fees have been collected from a base of over 18,000 unique entities who access from the registry. As part of that opt-out and enforcement regimen, the FTC stood prepared to initiate cases under its telecommunications sales rules to obtain temporary and permanent injunctions against violations secure orders for more than $500,000 in consumer restitution and refer civil penalty actions to the Department of Justice. Almost a year before Associate Director Gresham's 2010 testimony, and following 2 days of FTC town hall meetings on online behavior tracking in the fall of 2007, the Consumer Federation of America and other privacy groups noted that self-regulatory initiatives devised by industry had sadly failed. One of those groups, the Consumer Federation of America, which happens to be represented today by Ms. Susan Grant, called upon the FTC way back then to implement a one-stop opt-out for online tracking similar to the agency's successful Do Not Call registry. At the end of the second session of the 111th Congress, it would appear that we have come full circle with the FTC's endorsement of a Do Not Track mechanism that was released just yesterday as part of its 122 preliminary staff report. The title of that draft report is Protecting Consumer Protection in the Era of Rapid Change. Being the last hearing of this subcommittee that I will chair in this Congress, please allow me to reflect briefly on some of the major accomplishments and achievements of the CTCP subcommittee over the 110th and 111th Congresses. With the assistance of my able colleagues on both sides of the aisle, I have convened hearings, markups, and helped to guide, under the leadership of Chairman Waxman, to guide successfully more than a dozen bills out of the full committee, including the Consumer Product Safety Improvement Act and the Wall Street Reform Act. Our subcommittee was also very active in conducting oversight over the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration in the wake of massive recalls of unsafe automobiles. We've also asked questions at hearings about the effects of the disastrous Macondo oil well spill on the Gulf area tourism and travel industry and the health effects of formaldehyde on purchases of post-Katrina trailers. I am immensely proud of the collaboration that has existed between this subcommittee and the CTI, the Communication Technology and Internet Subcommittee, currently led by my friend, Chairman Boucher. In working closely with CTI to conduct oversight and to draft legislation, our two subcommittees held 6 joint hearings during the 111th Congress on a range of public safety and consumer protection topics, including texting, while driving, and online and offline privacy. And I do believe that the record will show that this subcommittee was highly productive, very effective in accomplishing a lot, much, in a relatively short period of time. With that said, I once again thank the witnesses for coming in this morning. I thank my colleagues on both sides of the aisle who are members of the subcommittee, and I yield back the balance of my time. And I recognize now the ranking member of the subcommittee, Mr. Whitfield, for 5 minutes for the purposes of opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Rush, and we appreciate your holding this hearing today on the Do Not Track concept. I say that because I don't think we really have any legislation, but it is an idea. And we all recognize that consumer protection for the internet is an important issue and one that I'm glad this subcommittee continues to address. I believe that all of us understand that the Do Not Call registry, which was developed over many years of legislation and dialogue, has been very successful because it does provide a mechanism for consumers to stop unsolicited cold calls from telemarketers. However, I am concerned with taking a similar model and applying it to the internet by establishing a do not track system, simply because we're not really comparing apples to apples. First, I'm not sure the technology is in place to establish such a mechanism. It is my understanding that there are several competing technologies out there on how exactly to create a do not track list. And so the question would be, is the government really the best entity to make that decision? I also think we need to ask what will happen to advertisement-supported internet content if a do not track system is implemented. In order for internet content to remain largely free to consumers, it is supported by advertising. Would an advertising model be sustainable in the absence of marketers' ability to track? In addition, I assume most consumers would rather see advertisements they are interested in rather than completely irrelevant advertising. So if a do-not-track system was implemented, would consumers receive less relevant ads? While I agree it is important for consumers to have an understanding of what information is being collected and how it is used, we need to seriously discuss the do-not-track model to evaluate whether it accomplishes the appropriate objectives. Some have expressed concern that a one-size-fits-all do-not-track model could impact consumers' choices by preventing their access to the benefits of online advertising. Personally, I believe a better approach may be to empower consumers to have a better control over their online experience. For example, why not have disclosures which let consumers know what type of information is being collected and how it is being used, or allow consumers to tailor their online browsing experience so that they may promptly have the benefits of information specific to their interest. Lastly, I think we should be mindful about the economic impact this proposal could have, particularly since we are in the middle of the holiday gift-giving season, and we understand that more shoppers are buying their holiday gifts online each year, a benefit to many consumers and businesses that never would have reached each other before the internet became mainstream. We need to be mindful not to enact legislation that would hurt a recovering economy. To that end, I'm curious to find out if there have been any economic impact studies or reports to see how implementing a do-not-track system would impact our economy. Once again, I appreciate Chairman Rush's interest in the issue, his strong dedication to online privacy, and I look forward to the testimony of our witnesses today. And one other comment that I might make on an unrelated matter, I know that Chairman Ganikowski and the FCC are looking at issuing some new net neutrality rules. As we know, there's been some court decisions on that issue, and I would hope that the FCC does not move in that direction right now and give us an opportunity to further explore that issue here in the Congress. And I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I think there are 5 minutes remaining. 2 minutes. Two minutes, okay. Well, the committee, subcommittee now stand in recess until the conclusion of these series of 5 votes on the floor.
The hearing will come to order, and we were in the middle of opening statements when we were called for a vote, and I believe the gentleman from Nebraska, Mr. Terry.
Thank you, Mr. Space. The issue that we're here on targeting and creating this do not target list or whatever it'll be called is, I think it's worthy of discussion and looking into. Of course, it's going to be an issue of how we define it and how we really help consumers here. I was one of the 8, I think, classified the do not call 8. There were 8 of us that voted against the do not call list. And there's ways of helping consumers and not helping consumers. We want to make sure we do it the right way. I'm actually more frustrated with the FCC than either two of you sitting here today, and the actions taken by the FCC chairman to usurp congressional power and authority in a new proposed order of regulating the internet. Certainly doing that on the eve of a new Congress is a message to us that they want to ram it down the public's throats before an opportunity comes for a different majority in the House of Representatives. But the issue is very bipartisan against the FCC's power grab. The order has been circulated amongst the members. We don't get to see it in Congress yet. This committee, Energy and Commerce, Telecom Subcommittee, partially this subcommittee have authority, jurisdiction. We're cut out of the deal. AT&T has ostensibly agreed to something under duress, is my personal opinion. It was either you agree to this or we're really going to come after you. And I think those type of tactics of the public not knowing what that order of how to regulate the internet, doing it under duress, making parties agree to things under threat of, well, it'll be worse for you if you don't. Those are the type of tactics that the public rejected on November 2nd. And so I'd call on the FCC to stand down. Don't go forward with the proposed order on regulating the internet. Yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Terry. The gentlewoman from Ohio, Ms. Sutton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will just submit my opening statement for the record so we can move along to the testimony. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Sutton. The congressman from Louisiana, Mr. Scalise.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've learned at previous hearings that web tracking can provide valuable information to businesses and marketers, thus enabling them to provide targeted online advertisements. And these benefits are not just limited to businesses. Consumers can enjoy a personalized web experience and receive ads tailored to their interests without having to search or sit through a sales pitch. And just as important, tracking and behavioral advertisements benefit the internet itself because it helps underwrite the cost of these sites that so many consumers enjoy with many of these services that are provided for free. But we also recognize the growing concern over the information that is collected on consumers, many of whom may not even know that their online activity is being tracked, and the potential for that personal information to be compromised or used illegally. That is why we must proceed prudently and find the appropriate balance between protecting consumers and promoting a dynamic internet environment that continues to produce the innovations and advancements that we've all come to enjoy. Our first step should not be finding ways government can regulate the issue. We do not need more government directives on the internet. A surefire way to stifle innovation would be to pass more government regulations that restrict innovation in this dynamic industry without proper approach. Constructive roles for government to play would include encouraging public-private partnerships, promoting best practices, and encouraging investment, innovation, and competition. But I believe we must first look to self-regulation and what steps the industry will take and has already taken to protect consumers. Today we can see examples of self-regulation, including the development of built-in opt-out mechanisms on internet browsers. We must also further examine the concept of do not track. The idea itself leads to questions that must be answered as we move forward. Will a do not track mechanism adequately protect consumers in light of developing technologies? Will it be consistent across different industries and technologies? And will it restrict the exchange and use of consumer data in ways that deter innovation and growth? As I've stated at previous hearings, the technology and internet industries are among the most advanced and competitive in our country, and they are also among the most beneficial both for consumers and our economy. And they have achieved this status by advancing and growing on their own with little interference from the federal government, and some would say that's one of the reasons that they've been so successful in innovating. We must continue to allow these industries to develop and innovate, and I believe we can do this in a way that strengthens consumer privacy. Protecting consumers and protecting the internet economy are not mutually exclusive goals. We must ensure that government intervention does not stifle innovation. And finally, I will chime in and concur in what my colleague from Nebraska said. I strongly oppose the effort by the FCC to regulate the internet through net neutrality, and especially in some dark of night attempt that didn't go through the proper scrutiny that it deserves. So thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Scalise. And seeing no other members present, at this point I would like to introduce and thank our witnesses for appearing before the committee today. We have with us today Mr. Daniel Weitzner, Associate Administrator for Policy at the National Telecommunications and Information Administration and U.S. Department of Commerce. Also, Mr. David Vladek, Director of the Bureau of Consumer Protection with the FTC. Welcome, gentlemen. It is the practice of the subcommittee to swear in witnesses, but I ask that you stand and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Please let the record reflect that the witnesses have answered in the affirmative. And with that, I would introduce again Mr. Weitzner for his five-minute opening statement.
Thank you, Congressman Space and Ranking Member Whitfield and members of the subcommittee. I thank you for the opportunity to testify on behalf of the United States Department of Commerce and the National Telecommunications and Information Administration. NTIA appreciates your leadership on commercial privacy policy and thanks you for the opportunity to engage on the question of how best to protect consumer privacy in the rapidly evolving internet age. I'm especially pleased to be here with my colleague David Vladek, and I hope you'll allow me to congratulate the FTC on the important privacy report that they released yesterday. Their expert insight on privacy matters will certainly inform the administration's thinking on the issue going forward. I know it's a lot of work to get those out, so thank you. I'd like to highlight 3 points from my written remarks, if I could. First, the Commerce Department's approach to privacy is as part of our overall efforts to develop innovation-sustaining internet policy principles. Second, the urgency for the United States to reassert global leadership on privacy policy. And third, our view of how to approach the goals behind the Do Not Track concept. We're all well aware of the transformations enabled by the internet. Politics, education, scientific research, healthcare, and even romance have all moved online. These powerful, exciting, and innovative developments also feed a growing concern among citizens about how their data is being stored, monitored, and analyzed. This is the policy challenge that confronts us. To harness the full potential of the digital age, we need to establish ground rules that promote innovative uses of information while building a well-founded sense of trust that consumers' legitimate expectations of privacy will be respected. Earlier this year, in order to develop a broad policy framework that promotes innovation in the internet environment, Commerce Secretary Gary Locke established the department's Internet Policy Task Force. The task force, which draws from a number of bureaus in the Commerce Department, including my own, NIST, the Patent and Trademark Office, the International Trade Administration, and others, is developing policy recommendations in a range of areas, including protecting privacy, assuring cybersecurity, establishing balanced copyright protection models, and preserving the global free flow of information. Consumer privacy is our first order of business. After consulting with a wide variety of consumer and commercial stakeholders, we've heard the unmistakable message that it is time to shore up privacy protection in the United States and abroad. So what needs to be done to enhance privacy protection while encouraging ongoing innovation? First, we need to affirm a privacy baseline regarding the handling of consumer information. This baseline should be built on a full set of fair information practice principles. To paraphrase a comment we received in our notice of inquiry, baseline FIPS are something that consumers want, companies need, and the economy will appreciate. Second, we realize that the government is not going to have all the answers. With or without legislation, the centerpiece of internet privacy protection will have to be an increased sense of urgency and incentives for the development of voluntary but enforceable codes of conduct. These are what Chairman Rush's bill calls choice programs and safe harbors. This approach recognizes that technologists and entrepreneurs, privacy and consumer advocates, business and the government have to work together to develop best practices for managing commercial data. Best practices or code of conduct are an indispensable mechanism by which all companies must adopt a strategy for implementing fair information practices. In order to be sure that these codes of conduct reflect the perspective of all stakeholders, all these stakeholders must be involved in the development of these codes. The alternative, however, is to wait for lengthy and conceivably contentious agency rulemaking procedures. This will neither serve consumers who need protection in today's new services, nor businesses which need flexibility in the application of privacy rules. The FTC, through after-the-fact enforcement, would provide critical legal assurance to consumers that the companies are actually adhering to the commitments that they make. Finally, I want to say that there's an urgent need to renew our commitment to leadership in the global privacy policy debate. All around the world, including in the European Union, policymakers are rethinking their privacy frameworks. As leaders in the global internet economy, it is incumbent on the United States to develop an online privacy framework that enhances trust and encourages innovation. Congressional leadership, continued FTC enforcement efforts, and administration engagement will all be important to show the world that the U.S. has a strong privacy framework and that we are committed to strengthening it further. Turning to the question of do not track, allow me to just start from first principles. We believe that individual choice and control over the flow of information has always been the foundation of internet policy. To the extent that tools provide effective protection for individual choices, government properly avoids regulations that would otherwise restrict the free flow of information. There's been continued innovation in these tools available to users over time, but we believe that we need to see more rapid action by businesses in providing users with easy-to-understand ability to control how their personal information is used. I just want to say in closing all the members of the committee that I think that we've seen across the history of internet policymaking strong bipartisan commitment to helping the internet to develop, to keeping it open, and to protecting people's basic rights. We saw this with Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act that is a foundation of our internet policy framework. We saw it with the notice and takedown provisions in the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, and even in institutions such as the Congressional Internet Caucus. They've all benefited from leadership of support of Democratic and Republican members of Congress alike. Like these other issues, safeguarding consumer privacy, we hope, will remain a bipartisan priority, and we look forward to this committee's continued leadership in the next Congress. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Weitzner. And Mr. Vladek, you have 5 minutes for your opening testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Space. Ranking Member Whitfield, members of the subcommittee, I appreciate the opportunity to be here today to underscore the Commission's support for Do Not Track, a view shared by four of our commissioners. At this point, the Commission has not taken a position on how Do Not Track should be implemented. But before I discuss Do Not Track specifically, let me note that it is only one aspect of a robust framework for protecting consumer privacy. Throughout its 40-year history of enforcement and policymaking experience, the Commission has tried to protect consumer privacy and build consumer trust in a fast-evolving marketplace. Yesterday, the Commission issued a preliminary staff report on protecting consumer privacy in the marketplace. This report makes three main points. One, companies should adopt a privacy-by-design approach, baking in protections like security and accuracy throughout their business processes. Two, current practices place too heavy a burden on consumers to safeguard their own privacy. Companies should provide choices about data collection and sharing in a simpler way at a time when consumers are making decisions about their data. And consumer decisions, once made, need to be respected. And three, companies should improve transparency of their information collection and use practices. Now, Do Not Track is an important component of the second piece of the framework because it would allow consumers to exercise choices about online tracking in a simple, universal, and persistent way. We believe that there's strong public support for a new Do Not Track mechanism, that it is technologically feasible and enforceable, and that once implemented, it will put consumers back in control of their own data. Now, we've heard three main objections to the Commission's proposal for Do Not Track mechanism that I would like to discuss. Objection number one, Do Not Track would create new privacy problems because it would require the federal government to create a registry or list of consumers who do not want to be tracked. Our response, we're not proposing the creation of a list, nor are we proposing a centralized system managed by the federal government. Well, the FTC must be able to ensure through enforcement that a do-not-track mechanism effectively implements consumer choice. There is no need for a do-not-track mechanism to be administered by the federal government. Objection two, industry already provides adequate opt-out choices to consumers. The FTC's response, self-regulation has been too slow to afford consumers meaningful choice. Many industry representatives agree with the Federal Trade Commission that providing consumers with choices about third-party tracking is essential to build the trust necessary for the marketplace to grow. So in that respect, there's no difference between the Federal Trade Commission and industry. And some industries have members have taken policy, have taken important positive steps. But existing choices are hard to find and hard to use. Many of these mechanisms also may lead consumers to believe that they are opting out of third-party tracking when, in fact, they are just opting out of receiving targeted ads. Finally, these mechanisms may not be fully effective. Consumers may believe they've opted out of tracking if they block third-party cookies on their browser, yet they still may be tracked through flash cookies and other devices. A robust do-not-track mechanism must be clear, easy to locate and use, and effectively implement the user's choice to opt out of third-party tracking. Objection number three, do-not-track is neither feasible nor enforceable. The FTC's response. We've learned from our roundtables and from the technologists we have on staff that a do-not-track mechanism is feasible technologically. Browsers or computers could be programmed to send a do-not-track signal as the consumers surf the web. Servers run by ad networks and other companies engaged in tracking would be programmed to receive and honor that request. Most importantly, this do-not-track setting would be designed to apply to all third-party tracking methods, thereby putting an end to the current arms race in which some companies subvert consumer choice by developing and using new tracking technologies. Compliance with tracking is essential, with tracking by companies is essential. But tracking leaves digital footprints, and the technical means exist that may identify parties that do not respect consumer choice. We believe that these tools can be effective in oversight and enforcement. Although we are confident that Do Not Track is feasible and can be effective, we are seeking comment on the best way to implement this mechanism. Let me conclude by saying that if Congress chooses to enact legislation, the Commission requests authority to conduct APA rulemaking and to obtain civil penalties for violations. Rulemaking is important so that the Commission can have flexibility in an area where technology evolves rapidly. And the ability to find violators would provide strong incentives for companies to comply with any legal requirements, helping to deter future violations. Thank you. We're happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Vladek. And at this time, the Chair will entertain questions of the witnesses. And our first on the list will be our Chairman Emeritus, Mr. Dingell.
Mr. Chairman, you have the time that you have and I have is very limited. So if you please, gentlemen, could you give me yes or no answers to the first question here? Do you believe the current industry efforts to regulate itself with respect to consumer data privacy are sufficient enough to address consumer concerns? Yes or no?
No.
Sir?
No.
Now, gentlemen, again, yes or no. Do you believe that such efforts can be improved, or do you believe that the Congress should pass comprehensive online privacy legislation?
That's two questions.
Well, all right. Then to the first half, yes or no, and then to the second half, yes or no. And you're perfectly
half,
right.
Yes, we believe that self-regulation can improve the current system. And with respect to the second question, the Commission has not taken a position on whether legislation is needed.
Okay, sir?
With respect to the first question, we're confident that the industry efforts can improve. With respect to the second question, the administration hasn't taken a position yet.
Now, gentlemen, here's a problem that I think all of us confront. Is there a single federal agency that is capable of implementing and enforcing do not track requirements? Is there a single agency?
We believe there is.
Okay. Now, then, and sir, your comment, if you please.
I think there's an agency that could.
All right. Now, which one is it or which one should it be? FTC, NTIA, or the FCC?
You go first on that.
We believe that we have both the ability and the enforcement infrastructure. Of those agencies, the Federal Trade Commission is the enforcement agency, and we think that we are up to the task.
We have great confidence in the FTC as an enforcement agency, and NTIA, as you know, is not a regulatory agency.
And I hope you don't take that as being an unfair question to you. Very frankly, I would make this observation. The FTC has a rather proud record of doing these kinds of things at the behest of the Congress and doing them well. Now, gentlemen, again, advertising plays an essential role in the support of free websites and internet applications. What impact would and this can't be a yes or no question, what impact would a do not track proposal have on that support?
I think the answer is going to depend quite a bit on what the do not track mechanism is and what it means. What we know is that there are more and more companies that are offering users some kind of opt-out and enhanced notice mechanism. I don't believe that we've seen dramatic fall-off of advertising revenue as a result. I think that there are mechanisms that could be mandated, which could have a dramatic impact on advertising revenue. I think that counsels to look at the issue very carefully so that we don't disrupt the internet economy.
It is a concern then.
Yes.
Thank you. Now, gentlemen, should a do not track mechanism involve simply no collection of information, or should it include a prohibition on the use of such information to target consumers?
I'll take the first stab at that. I think that what we envision is a do not track mechanism that would permit consumers, first of all, we don't believe that a do not track mechanism is necessarily an all or nothing, one time or forever mechanism. We believe that the point of do not track is to give consumers control over the collection of data through tracking that they do not want to have collected. And so if you look at both the testimony, our report, and the questions that the report poses for industry, we want to explore tailored do not track that would enable consumers to permit certain kind of tracking, but to exclude other kind of data collection and therefore data use.
Sure.
I would say that data collection limitations are a very blunt instrument and tend to have unexpected consequences and sometimes may make false promises to users. I think that the concerns that we see, however, are split between concerns about collection and concerns about use. It's a difficult question.
Now, gentlemen, and my time is running out here, it seems that do not track, as it is presently discussed, is all or nothing, meaning that either a user permits his data to be collected or he does not allow such data to be collected. Is there a middle-of-the-road approach that could be adopted and a regulatory structure that could be constructed that would enable us to do this in a proper way, giving consideration to the concerns of everybody?
I think the answer to your question is yes. And one of the things the Federal Trade Commission is exploring is a do not track mechanism that provides consumers with great choice about what information they're willing to have collected through tracking and what information they're not.
Sometimes.
And so our effort is to, and we've solicited comment on this, but our effort is to devise a system that gives consumers very broad and granular control over the tracking of their personal information.
Sir?
Congressman Dingell, I think it's very important to recognize that this question doesn't arise in a vacuum. For 10 or 15 years in the evolution of the internet advertising environment, we've had an evolution of mechanisms that gives users increasing control over how their information is used and increasing awareness of how it's used. We think it's very important to continue that trend. I think to encourage that to continue to happen. I think that will help to get to some of the more nuanced mechanisms that my colleague, Mr. Vladek, is talking about.
Thank you, gentlemen. Mr. Chairman, I would like to pay just a brief word of tribute to you. You have served here well and with distinction. I'm proud to see you running the committee today. I'm grateful to you for your excellent service in this institution. And I want to congratulate you and commend you and wish you well on behalf of John Dingell and I think on behalf of the rest of my colleagues in the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Our next questioner is Ranking Member Mr. Whitfield of Kentucky.
Well, thank you very much. I would like to echo Mr. Dingell's comments, Mr. Space, and tell you how much we enjoyed serving with you, and we know we'll look forward to seeing you in the future as we move along. Thank you all for your testimony very much. We appreciate it. With the release of the privacy report yesterday, I believe Chairman Leibowitz referred to a privacy deficit, and he sort of compared that to a budget deficit, and there's no question we have a budget deficit. And so that raises the question, when he's talking about a privacy deficit, and I think both of you have indicated you're not advocating legislation, do not track legislation at this time, how severe do you think this privacy deficit is that Mr. Leibowitz talked about yesterday?
If we spent a full year developing a record that underpins the report that we issued yesterday. And there are two themes that I think emerged from the roundtables that we held and from our interactions with every imaginable stakeholder. One is the general concern that consumers are not aware that they're being tracked online and the extent of tracking, and what has really happened, which is there's a commodity now in personal data. There is a, you know, there's a data collection and use industry. And so I think one concern is that we need to make this clear to the public. We need to educate the public. And I suspect that when Chairman Leibowitz was talking about the deficit, that was part of what he was addressing. The other theme is that people do not feel they have adequate control over their data when they browse. And I recognize that industry has come up with some browser-based options and some other efforts to try to respond to consumer demand for greater control. Our concern is those efforts have fallen short. And one of the reasons why we thought we needed to issue this report is to talk about the gap, the mismatch between consumer demand and expectation and what's presently being offered. And we're hoping that a report will stimulate discussions like this so we all collectively can move forward.
Thank you.
Congressman Whitfield, here's what I think we know. I wouldn't necessarily say that we have a deficit because that presumes it's quantifiable in some way. But I think we have two almost disparate facts, almost contradictory facts before us. We see people using the internet more and more and more. We had a very positive Cyber Monday, or if that's what it's called. And so we see people embracing this technology in so many ways, and we certainly want that to continue. What we also know from surveys, from public comments, from the consultations that we've done at the Commerce Department with a very wide range of stakeholders, is that there's increasing concern on the part of the public about how privacy is being handled. People are not sure exactly what their rights are. They're not exactly sure how to protect them, who to go to when they feel wronged. I think that if there's a gap, it is perhaps there in the fact that the internet is more and more important to us, but we have increasing uncertainties. And I think it is worth working collectively to close that gap.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. recognizing that the advertising model is so important to the internet and trying to balance that versus privacy protections, do both of you feel confident that we could come to a solution on this issue at somewhere down the road where you can protect both of these in an adequate manner?
I think that what we've seen, as I alluded to in the previous interchange, is that internet users have actually been given more and more control through the various services that we all use on the internet. And we haven't seen advertising revenue go down. If anything, we've seen it go up, and we've seen it proliferate into a whole variety of new business models. That's a very positive trend. I think we'd certainly want to watch very carefully to make sure not to take steps that would turn that in the other direction. But I think it's a mistake to assume that giving people more control means a reduction in advertising revenue.
Okay. Yeah, we share that view, and let me make two brief points. One is, no one wants to interfere with innovation and business development on the internet. It's a very powerful engine that drives a big part of our economy. But we don't want to sacrifice consumer privacy at the same time. And in fairness to industry, industry recognizes this. I mean, the advertisers have banded together to give consumers opt-out rights against targeted advertising. I can't imagine that they would want to kill the golden goose that laid the golden egg. And so I think that in terms of our aspirational goals, we're not that far apart.
Well, thank you very much. We really appreciate your testimony, and my time has expired, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Green from Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask unanimous consent to my statement be placed into the record. And thank each of you for being here. This is an issue that our committee, and not only this subcommittee on consumer affairs, but also our telecom subcommittee, has dealt with for many years. And I've always come down on the side of if I'm using the internet, I would rather have the option of opting in to have someone track me than opting out. And that's my first question, is constructing a framework that allowed the internet users to actively opt in to tracking be more feasible approach. Now, we know in practicality, very few people will opt in. And if you opt out, there'll be more people who just won't take the time to opt out. What are the strengths of the opt-in, and what is the how is the do not track better? The two options, opt-in or opt-out?
Let me answer that question in two ways. In terms of the strength of a do-not-track, our view is that it would be uniform, easy to use, and durable choice by consumers. A choice they can change and a choice they can modify. But under the existing regime, in order for consumers to, for example, not receive delivered targeted behavioral advertising, they have to go to multiple sites that are hard to use and often are confusing. So we're trying to relieve the burden on consumer to exercise choice, and in our view, a do not track mechanism is the ideal solution to that problem. Now, in terms of opt-in and in terms of opt-out, we've requested comment on this because we've seen both mechanisms used by marketers in a way that are confusing to consumers. Yeah. You've seen opt-ins that simply require you to click a button after reading through a long, end user licensing agreement that you don't read because no one reads them. And we've seen opt-out mechanisms that are also confusing to use. So what we're hoping to do here is to find a simple, easy to use, easy to find tool that consumers can use to express their choice about being tracked and how much they want to be tracked, if at all. That is the goal of the Federal Trade Commission.
Congressman Green, I just echo my colleagues' views here. Historically, as you know, the privacy debate has always been framed as this kind of stark opt-in versus opt-out choice. I think our goal should be to move beyond that and to create an easy set of choices for users to have access to when it makes sense for them to have access. I think that this opt-in, opt-out model really ignores the fact that internet technology can make choices much more easily and much more easy and much more accessible.
Will implementing a do not track list create a false sense of security for users? What can complement the Do Not Track system to keep users informed of the remaining potential data collections and tracking and inform them that measures they can take the limit if they choose? Because even if you opt out of the tracking, what's the security that you know that you're not being tracked?
I think that that comes in many ways to a definitional question about just what do not track or do not profile or do not advertise really comes to mean, and a question of who's ultimately going to be accountable to answer the preferences that are expressed by users. I'd say that I think there's a growing agreement in the technical community that it's not so hard to understand how to enable a user to send out a do not track signal. The question is who's supposed to listen to that signal, and I think that's a hard question to answer. As Mr. Vladek noted, we want to give users a subtle set of choices so that their complex preferences can be represented. But I think we risk if we try to draw lines too firmly, we do risk creating a false sense of security.
Well, can I respond briefly? We want to provide a sense of security, and one of the design features that can be built into a do not track mechanism is an end to what we now see as an arms race that many companies are engaged in defeating consumer choice by developing tracking devices that are not easily removed. And so part of our concern is we do not want to get into an endless cycle where a browser is able to remove cookies, tracking cookies, but isn't able to deal with flash cookies or super cookies or the next generation of tracking devices.
One of the concerns I have is, and we having dealt with this before, is there authority with the FTC and even with NTIA to do this? What's to keep it from happening in Great Britain or, you know, somewhere else, Switzerland or somewhere else? They just move those browsers there and we lose the ability to control them in our own country.
I think that the point that you're underscoring, Congressman Green, is the need to have broad agreement about just what these promises and these commitments really mean. What should a consumer really be able to expect? We've urged, as we've talked about this issue, the need to come to broad voluntary agreements amongst industry groups that spread across the globe and consumer groups that increasingly represent different countries so that we can have what is something closer to a global set of expectations. The internet is a global marketplace and we're going to need that more and more.
Well, there's another answer as well, Congressman, which is that if we successfully implement a do not track regime in the United States, tracking devices, for example, launched in another country, will not be able to track the consumer unless the consumer starts visiting sites somewhere else. So, that's a question that we've explored with our own technologists, including, and I'm happy to introduce Dr. Ed Felton, who's a Princeton University computer science professor who will be joining the Federal Trade Commission, is our chief technologist at the first of the year. But there are real disadvantages to trying to end run a do not track system simply by moving a server, into another country. And we'd be glad to, explain why that would not necessarily bypass a do not track system.
Well, I think having dealt with this for many years, I think our committee on a bipartisan basis falls on the side of the privacy. And my last question is, are there any types of information that do you feel that shouldn't be tracked or just hardcore shouldn't be collected at all?
One of the reasons why we have gravitated to a do not track option is because there are certainly categories of information, health information, family information, financial information, maybe information concerning not only children but teens, geolocation data, religious information, political information that people probably do not want tracked and that data collected. And therefore, a do not track option would empower consumers to avoid being tracked and have their data collected in those sensitive areas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Green. I do have a couple of questions of my own before we get to the next panel. First, I would be remiss if I didn't reference something that I always reference in hearings having to do with broadband and digital technology. And that is that, and I know it's a little off point, but it's important to a lot of people in this country who don't have any access to the internet. And I want to commend both the NTIA and the FTC for their efforts in promoting rural broadband access universally. That digital technology has become such a profound part of our everyday life experience, our economies, and it's happened in just the last 10 or 15 years. And imagine where we'll be in 10 or 15 years from now. So I mention that just because I want to underscore the importance of making up for this rural divide that exists in this country when it comes to access. The fact of the matter is digital communication is integrated very heavily into our economy and integrated very heavily into the everyday life of consumers in all realms, healthcare, education, et cetera. One of the concerns I have on this particular issue, the privacy issue, is the lack of sophistication of the normal consumer vis-a-vis that of the normal carrier and telecom provider. At the same time, I am cognizant of the importance of profitability and that the do not track legislation may have an adverse effect on that bottom line. I further understand that the industry itself has attempted several times to deal with the privacy concerns, and my assumption from your testimony is that you feel that it has inadequately done so. My understanding is that there is a coalition in the industry with approximately 5,000 participating companies, according to the Interactive Advertising Bureau, and that we checked just last week, I think there were 58 actual participating companies. I'd be interested in your impression as to the level of industry commitment to this issue and what non-legislative means might be available to help stimulate greater interest among industry.
Thank you, Congressman Space, and first of all, thank you for your attention and your leadership on the rural internet access issues. It's a major priority, as you know, for NTIA, and we appreciate your support on that. I would say that there have been ongoing industry efforts from the very beginning of the commercial internet environment to help users understand how to use their services, how to protect themselves, for example, against content that they don't want to receive, that they don't want their children to receive. And I would say as well, there have been efforts to help educate users about privacy protection. Those efforts, I believe, have to be ongoing and have to be stepped up. I think it's not fair to say that there have been no efforts, but certainly we think the efforts ought to be increased. In the work that we've been doing on privacy at the Department of Commerce, one of the things that we've learned is that it's really critical to develop what we've called a multi-stakeholder approach to privacy protection, to have industry groups working together with consumer advocates, together with regulators, together with state attorneys general, all of whom have a significant responsibility in this area, and we certainly hope going forward that it will be possible to find ways to encourage those efforts. They clearly have to be stepped up. I think that consumer education on the internet happens very often really through the design of services, not so much through talking to users. You think about how we've had millions, hundreds of millions of people learn to use the internet. It's been because services have been built so that they're easy to use, so that the tools that people want are accessible. And I think we have to apply that kind of innovation and accessibility to the privacy area.
Let me just add a few thoughts, if I may. One is, on the educational side, I agree completely with Mr. Weissner that we need to do more. One important recommendation we make in our privacy report is that we start engaging in privacy by design. We build privacy in from the start, and we need to do a better job of doing that. And on some of the smartphones, for example, now they'll let you know when your geolocation data is being shared. We need to broaden those kinds of technological innovations to alert consumers about privacy issues. Second, I think that, you know, the federal agencies need to do a better job, as well as industry, in terms of public education. We take public education very seriously. We've distributed now nearly 5 million copies of a booklet designed for parents and kids to learn about internet use, smartphone use. This is a book called Etc. That has been distributed in school districts around the country. And finally, the second point is that with respect to your industry stepping up to the plate question, nothing in our report and nothing in our testimony would preclude a robust, inclusive, enforceable, do not track regime, self-administered by industry, provided that these commitments were backed up by an enforceable regime such as the one that the Federal Trade Commission administers under Section 5. We need to have a system in place in which consumers have confidence that their choices are being respected. And there's nothing that would preclude a self-regulatory regime as long as at the end of the day there was a law enforcement agency that would be able to single out and to go after people who did not engage in that kind of respect.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. The gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Markey, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. As a co-chairman of the Bipartisan Privacy Caucus with Joe Barton and former chairman of the Telecommunications and Internet Subcommittee, I have long believed that consumers should have control over their own personal information. When it comes to kids and their use of the internet, it is particularly important that stringent privacy protections are applied so that children do not have their online behavior tracked or their personal information collected or disclosed. In 1998, I was the House author of the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, or COPPA, which was signed into law by President Clinton. COPPA places parents in control over what information is collected from their children online. My law covers children aged 13 and under, and it requires operators of commercial websites and online services directed to children under 13 to abide by various privacy safeguards as they collect, use, or disclose personal information about kids. Those requirements are still on the books and are kind of the Constitution right now for protection of children. And those were important safeguards. But in internet years, 1998 is so long ago. We might as well be talking about the Peloponnesian Wars. The 1990s was back in the BF era, before Facebook, just another time and place. Now is the time for new legislation to protect kids and to prevent them from being tracked online. That's why next year I plan to introduce comprehensive children's privacy legislation that will include a do not track requirement so that kids do not have their online behavior tracked or their personal information collected or profiled. I look forward to working with my colleagues to move this legislation forward. I also want to commend Common Sense Media and its CEO, Jim Steyer, for their excellent work in this area. For many kids, the internet is like online oxygen. They can't live without it. The internet enables kids to access incredible opportunities that were unimaginable only a few years ago. but we must also protect children from the dangers that can lurk in this online environment. And we thank the two of you for your long-standing commitment to ensuring that protection is there for children. May I ask, Mr. Vladek, in your testimony, you indicate that the Federal Trade Commission's support for development of a do-not-track capability so consumers can avoid having their activities monitored online. As you know, in its ongoing series on online privacy, the Wall Street Journal has reported that popular children's websites install more tracking technologies on personal computers than do the top websites aimed at adults. Now, I am extremely concerned by that trend. Is that practice used by those websites covered by COPPA?
Remember, we're talking, COPPA covers children 12 and under. And we believe it is that COPPA would apply. We have accelerated our review of COPPA in large measure because of exactly the concerns that you've outlined. That is, today, for many children, the internet is a playground, the sort that we used to play in, except they spend a lot of time on the internet. And so we have accelerated our review of our COPPA rule. We just held a roundtable a few months ago to explore these issues and other issues that are raised. It's online gaming sites where children spend a fair amount of time on, the migration of these interactive sites to smartphones. And so, yes, we share your concerns about this, and we look forward to working with you in crafting legislation.
Do you want legislation in the past that gives you the specific authority to be able to deal with these issues?
I'm not authorized to speak for the commission on this issue. I will say that in beginning our COPPA review process, one possible end of it would be legislative recommendations. And so our interests may well coincide here, because we're hoping to make our recommendations about COPPA within the next few months.
I'll be looking forward to your comments on my legislation. In response to the question of whether or not self-regulation in fact works in this industry, your answer is that
it has not. In our view, self-regulatory efforts have thus far fallen short.
And do you agree with that as well?
We think they could be a lot more urgent and robust, and we're looking at ways to encourage those efforts, particularly as to children.
The gentleman's time.
I thank the gentleman for the time that you've given me, and I thank you for your excellent service
to our
country as well.
Thank you. At this point, the chair recognizes the gentlewoman from the great state of Ohio, Betty Sutton.
I thank the chairman, and I too add my voice to those who thank you so very much for your service to our country and, of course, to the great state of Ohio. We appreciate all that you have done. You have made the lives of the people that I represent better through your service, and we'll miss you on this committee and in this Congress. Thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony. The first thing I want to talk about is the Wall Street going for web privacy software, that it's a challenge to get people to pay for web privacy software. Nonetheless, there are firms that are sprouting up that for a fee will help people protect their online privacy. And the purveyors of these companies, despite the slow going, appear sort of optimistic about the future of this. In fact, the head of one such firm has glowingly referred to the emergence of a quote, privacy economy, in response to a growing concern about the amount of information being collected and stored about each of us and how it could potentially be used. This particular service, for an ongoing fee, helps people scrub their online reputations and to remove themselves from tracking networks. One of the ways it gets data collectors to remove its clients' information is by paying them a fee. This notion of a privacy economy seems to be premised more on the idea that data collectors will make their money either by selling your information to someone else or by getting you to pay to stop it from being used. It also sounds like privacy is being transformed into a commodity available to those who can afford it. Gentlemen, should we be concerned that if government and industry fail to address quickly and appropriately and a more robust baseline privacy protections, that what we might have emerge instead is something like a privacy economy where some people will be able to buy privacy and others won't?
It's a complex question, Congresswoman Sutton. I would say that, first of all, it's great news that there's innovative energy out there looking to give people more control over their information, to shape their internet experience as they choose. I think we can all hope that those efforts succeed. I think that it's not clear that that's going to ever offer the whole answer to the privacy question. There's no doubt that there's money to be made, businesses to be developed in this increasingly complex economy of personal information, and we welcome that. Some of the privacy concerns that people have, however, are not economic. They're not just about whether they get a penny or two for the use of their information. It's about how trustworthy they feel the online environment is. It's about whether they're treated fairly by those who they do business with. So I think we have to always keep in mind that there's a non-economic component to this as well, where I think a lot of the Federal Trade Commission's work over the last decade has been very important.
Yeah, let me add one thought, which is we want to build confidence and trust in the internet economy. And having to pay a fee in order to engage in a retrospective effort to claw back personal information doesn't seem to us the right way to go about this.
And as I indicated in my question, that is actually what currently is starting to evolve. So, okay, I appreciate the work that both the FTC and the Department of Commerce have devoted thus far to developing the frameworks for protecting consumers' privacy, as indicated by your answers here today. And how to best protect consumers' privacy is clearly an important and complicated issue. But both the FTC and Commerce have devoted nearly a year to listening to and distilling stakeholders' views and recommendations on this issue. And the idea that a more robust and effective approach must be taken to protecting consumers' privacy has been percolating for even longer than that. And while the FTC report provides a proposed framework for protecting consumers' privacy, it also raises more questions and asks for more feedback. And I understand that. And I understand the report from the Department of Commerce is going to take the same approach. So, Mr. Weitzner, do you know when we should expect Commerce to issue its report?
We're hoping it'll be very soon now, Congresswoman Sutton. Certainly in weeks, not months, is our expectation.
And will that report also raise more questions and request more feedback?
It will, Congresswoman, I will say that our goal really is to be able to contribute to the public dialogue in general and also to the broad administration deliberation on privacy policy questions, including the question of how to respond to legislative proposals that are out there now and additional ones that will come. So we felt that we've had to do a very broad consultation, and we've had a chance to do that. We're optimistic that will contribute to the debate. We do feel a real sense of urgency about moving forward on this issue, both because of the domestic situation and also because of the global situation.
Does the gentlewoman yield the balance of her time?
More? Do I still have time? Because I'd love to ask more questions.
I'm sorry, you don't. Time has expired.
Have more time.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony. And dismissing you, I'd like to again extend the committee's gratitude for the work you do and for your testimony today. And I would ask that the second panel step forward to the table. And while you're situating yourselves, I will introduce you and then swear you in. We have with us Ms. Susan Grant, Director of Consumer Protection of the Consumer Federation of America, Mr. Joseph Pasqua, Vice President of Research, Symantec Corporation, Ms. Joan Gilman, Executive Vice President and President, Media Sales, Time Warner Cable, Dr. Eben Moglen, Legal Advisor, Professor of Law, Columbia University, Founding Director, Software Freedom Law Center, and Mr. Daniel Castro, Senior Analyst, Information Technology and Innovation Foundation. If you could find your seat, and then I would ask that you you rise so that I may administer the oath. Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Let the record reflect that the witnesses have all answered in the affirmative. Ms. Grant, I will start with you, but before we begin with the testimony, I find it necessary, Mr. Moglen, to make some specific remarks in advance. Before, once again, I yield the floor. We as members of Congress are never inclined to censor testimony or to influence a witness's remarks in open congressional forums, including this hearing. Having said that, Congress tries mightily to preserve the highest standards of decorum to foster the most constructive dialogue and debate possible on important matters like consumer privacy. Accordingly, I would ask you to provide your oral testimony without making any comments that could be construed as a personal attack against any company or any company, company's employees. And I would also ask for unanimous consent that Mr. Moglen be given an opportunity to revise his written remarks submit the same within 5 days. Hearing no objection, it is so granted. And with that, I would introduce Ms. Susan Grant, Director of Consumer Protection, Consumer Federation of America, for her 5 minutes of testimony.
Thank you. On behalf of Consumer Federation of America, an association... thank you. On behalf of Consumer Federation of America, an association of nearly 300 consumer organizations in the United States, I'm pleased to provide our perspective on this important question: is now the right time for do not track legislation? And our answer is, not surprisingly, yes. As a recent Wall Street Journal investigation series, What They Know, so clearly detailed, consumers are being tracked on the internet wherever they go, whatever they do, without their knowledge or consent. Information about their online activities, what they search for, what they click on, what they purchase, what they share with others, who their friends are in social networking sites, is compiled, analyzed, and used to profile them. Sometimes information is gathered about their offline activities to create even richer profiles. This tracking is primarily used for marketing at this point, but it can also be used to make assumptions about people for employment, housing, insurance, and financial services, for purposes of lawsuits against individuals, and for government surveillance. There are no limits to what this type of information can be used for, when information can be collected, how long it can be retained, and with whom it can be shared. As the Wall Street Journal characterized it, quote, one of the fastest growing businesses on the internet is the business of spying on consumers, end quote. If someone were following you around in the physical world, tailing you and making note of everywhere you go, what you read, who you talk to, what you eat, the music that you listen to, what you buy, what you watch, you might find this disturbing. The argument that we don't know your name, just the make and model of your car, and we're only going to use this information for advertising, might not assuage your concerns about being stalked. On the internet, even if the tracker doesn't know your name, you are not anonymous. As the Federal Trade Commission and members of Congress have recognized, your internet protocol address and other unique persistent identifiers are essentially essentially personally identifying information. And as the Wall Street Journal put it, the skill of data handlers is, quote, transforming the internet into a place where people are becoming anonymous in name only, end quote. The ability to cross-reference data makes it easy to make assumptions about people and treat them a certain way based on information that's been collected about their activities, even if you don't know their names. Furthermore, as news reports and scholarly articles have described, it's relatively easy to re-identify data that's supposedly anonymous. With more and more people using the internet as an essential tool for communications, education, managing their finances, researching health and other sensitive subjects, buying goods and services, sharing information through social networks, engaging in political and civil discourse, accessing government programs and benefits, and storing personal and workplace documents, it's crucial that they be able to exert effective control over the collection and use of what is gleaned about their online activities. No matter what one thinks about the benefits and risks of online tracking and behavioral advertising, and there are many differing views, the fact is that consumers have the basic right to privacy, and that right should be respected. While online behavioral tracking and targeting is less visible to consumers than telemarketing, surveys clearly show that people are uncomfortable with this practice. For instance, a 2009 survey by researchers at the University of Pennsylvania and the University of California found that 66% of respondents did not want websites they visit to show them tailored ads. And when the common tracking methods were explained to them, an even higher number rejected tailored advertising. More recently, a poll commissioned by the nonprofit organization Consumer Watchdog this past July revealed that 90% of Americans wanted more laws to protect privacy, 86% favored the creation of an anonymous button that allows you to go online without being tracked, and 80% wanted a do not track me list. When the FTC announced in 2003 that it was creating the National Do Not Call Registry, it acknowledged that the company-specific approach, which obliged consumers to inform each company one by one that they didn't want to receive telemarketing calls, was, quote, seriously inadequate to protect consumers' privacy from an abusive pattern of calls from a seller or telemarketer, end quote, and that consumers were angered and frustrated by the telemarketing calls that they were receiving. The FTC also said that industry self-regulatory programs, such as the Direct Marketing Association's telephone preference service, fell short because they were voluntary and, to quote them, to the extent that sanctions exist for non-compliance, DMA may apply those sanctions only against its members, not non-members, end quote. The National Do Not Call Registry is a big success because it provides consumers who don't want to receive telemarketing calls with an easy-to-use mechanism to opt out. And just as importantly, telemarketers have to honor their opt-out request. As noted in the privacy report released by the FTC yesterday, voluntary programs by individual companies and industry associations through which consumers can opt out of online tracking are not adequate. We agree with the FTC that these programs have not been implemented widely enough, that consumers are unaware of them, that consumers may be confused by the lack of clarity and uniformity in the way that these various programs work, that these programs may not may result in blocking personalized advertising from being delivered to consumers, but may in fact not stop tracking, which could be used for other purposes, and that because these programs rely on cookies, they are not necessarily effective against all forms of tracking or persistent. Now is the time to create an easy-to-use mechanism for consumers who want to opt out of online tracking if they wish to do so, and a legal requirement to honor their decisions. And this could be done in a way where consumers could give permission to specific trackers for specific purposes if they wished. Our ideas about how Do Not Track would work have evolved over time. Again, this would not be a list like the Do Not Call registry, but would instead be a setting in web browsers that consumers could use to indicate that they don't want to be tracked. The browsers would express the consumer's preference to the websites that they visit. I'm not a technologist, but there are other experts from the Electronic Frontier Foundation and elsewhere, and we heard from the FTC that its experts concur that this mechanism would be easy to implement and simple for both consumers and trackers to use. In our vision, all browsers would be required to include a do not track mechanism as a standard feature at no extra cost to consumers, and just as importantly, all trackers should be required to honor consumers' preferences. Industry members would obviously have to work together, as they often do, in implementing technologies that have to be interoperable to ensure that these mechanisms work as intended. And we think that the FTC would have to be required to perform audits in mystery browsing to ensure that trackers are indeed complying with consumers' requests, since it's very difficult for consumers to tell themselves whether they're being tracked or how their information is being
used. Ms. Grant, if I could ask that you wrap it up. Unfortunately, we have a lot of witnesses.
I'm sorry. That's why I was speaking so fast. Let me just conclude by saying that we have other concerns that will not necessarily be eliminated by Do Not Track, but to the extent that Do Not Track gives consumers an effective way to control the collection and use of their personal information, those concerns are ameliorated. So we look forward to working with Congress on the creation of a Do Not Track tool for consumers.
Thank you, Ms. Grant. Our next witness, Mr. Joseph Pasqua, Vice President of Research, Symantec Corporation.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Whitfield, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to be here today as you consider a national Do Not Track proposal in an effort to protect consumer online privacy. As the global information security leader, Symantec supports Congress's goal to protect privacy and enhance consumer trust online. Today, I would like the committee to take away three key points from my testimony. First, online privacy is not possible without security. Through spyware and certain harmful adware, online advertising can, and increasingly does, present a critical threat to security and therefore privacy on the internet. Second, while privacy legislation can help protect Americans in the online world, we urge the committee to focus on regulating malicious behavior rather than underlying technologies. Privacy laws should avoid the trap of defining good or bad technology in order to avoid undermining both innovation and security. Third, while online privacy and security together are a critical foundation to trust on the internet, the creation of a Do Not Track registry would be unlikely to advance these goals. Instead, Congress should focus on policies that foster an online environment where individuals and organizations can complete transactions with confidence, trusting each other's identities and the infrastructure on which the transactions run. Symantec believes that online privacy is a cornerstone of consumer trust. And let me just say that Do Not Track, and that mechanism is only one piece, as an earlier witness said, of the overall privacy question online. Without security, however, the expense of compliance and lost economic activity from individual privacy regulations may not be worth it. We urge Congress to deal with security first and not to inadvertently create impediments to security through new privacy laws or new safeguards will amount to closing the barn door after the horses have left. The advantages of doing business over the internet are tremendous, but only if exchanging information in cyberspace is secure. Interaction with websites increasingly demands personal information, yet sharing such data requires trusting business partners and the integrity of transaction records online so individuals do not become victims of identity theft or fraud. The increased prevalence and complexity of online advertising make it a ripe target for attackers. Because an advertisement is basically a piece of software, the potential exists for that software to be malicious. Online behavioral advertising is not inherently bad, but it does carry with it, sometimes literally, collateral threats to information security. A whole class of threats, commonly known as spyware or malicious adware, has proliferated over the last few years. Fortunately, the marketplace is responding to the need to address these challenges. Cybersecurity companies are investing heavily in newer generations of behavioral detection and whitelisting technologies to handle the increasing volume and variety of spyware and malicious code threats. For our part, Symantec creates security programs that watch out for the most current malicious threats, as well as unknown software that exhibits suspicious behavior. The committee may find it of interest that given the millions of threats that Symantec products block every day, the detection most frequently encountered by our Norton antivirus users is a tracking cookie over everything else. And while many types of cookies serve a useful purpose and are used on most websites, tracking cookies are a privacy concern. Given the prevalence of malware, including harmful adware and spyware, it is no surprise that there has been so much discussion about preventing advertising networks from being able to track the websites that consumers are visiting and other information about those consumers. The proposed do not track list conceptually seems to be reasonable, but in practice would be an extremely difficult technical task. In order to abide by an instruction not to track, a website must have a way to recognize that a given user connecting to that site has requested that they not be tracked. Because it is analogous to using phone numbers to identify a do not call list, consideration has been given to using IP addresses to recognize a connecting user. This approach is problematic, as has been discussed earlier. IP addresses aren't really analogous to phone numbers. They change. Tracking them introduces their own security concerns. There is another concept, but basically a reverse, which would be a do not track registry, which has also been discussed. And it implies advertisers would register their domains in a do not track registries, and browser plugins would enforce that. Symantec believes that that scenario could cause disruption to the user experience, significant disruption, and could influence the habits and fluidity of users' experience on the internet. We've also heard today and in previous testimony about a proposed solution where a header information is sent from the browser, from the user's computer, to the internet expressing the user's privacy preferences. And that's a reasonable approach, but we'd also like to indicate that the browser alone is not enough to support that. You have to have enforcement on the server side, and that can make things difficult. And in summary, I'd like to just point out one other thing. We've been talking a lot about browsers and consumers today using websites, but that's just one form of tracking. In the coming years, everything's going to be connected to the internet. Your DVR is connected to the internet. Your dishwasher is going to be connected to the internet. Certainly your mobile phone. Advertisers would, in theory, be able to know how many loads of laundry you're doing a day. So we need to think about tracking and privacy in a broader scope than just browsers, though they're an important first step.
Thank you, Mr. Pasqua. And our next panelist is Ms. Joan Gilman, Executive Vice President and President of Media Sales, Time Warner Cable.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Whitfield, and other members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss consumer privacy, including the potential for do not track legislation. For Time Warner Cable, our relationship with our customers is the bedrock foundation of our business. We operate in a highly competitive marketplace, and our ability to succeed depends on winning and retaining the trust of our customers. It is our job to preserve and strengthen that trust while delivering content and services to meet consumer needs, as well as introduce the benefits of innovative network technologies and capabilities. I will make 2 points today. First, do not track proposals cannot be considered in a vacuum, but rather must be part of a larger conversation about the appropriate role of government in ensuring consumer privacy as more content products and services move online. Second, we believe it would be premature to require do not track through legislation or regulation, given the still conceptual nature of such a requirement. I will address each of these in turn. Advertising has emerged as a key driver of an incredible array of online content, services, and applications available to users at little or no cost. The more effective the advertising, the greater the advertising revenues available to fund these products and services. Simply put, advertising is more effective if the message is more relevant. This makes advertising more valuable to both the consumer and the advertiser. Traditional advertisers have employed such practices for decades. We would respectfully suggest that the appropriate framework for policy discussions is how to establish policies that encourage innovation while protecting privacy. In the first instance, policymakers should rely on industry best practices to achieve this result. Consumers have a keen interest in safeguarding their privacy, but they also want information about products and services, and they want access to free or reasonably priced products and services that is possible only with broad-based advertiser support. It is in this context that policymakers should review the appropriateness of a do not track requirement. Do not track raises some unique questions that make it significantly more complex than the popular do not call list. For instance, how would do not track affect consumers' online experience and expectations? Would they receive more pop-up ads? How would it affect diversity on the internet? Would it negatively impact niche websites with small but loyal audiences? Would it prevent new websites from launching? With Do Not Track still at the conceptual stage, the next step should be industry-led efforts to refine and test the concept rather than legislation or regulation. The codification of a Do Not Track requirement could quickly become moot in light of developing technologies. In contrast, self-regulation and best practices can quickly evolve to address the dynamic online environment. And while we believe that it is premature for Congress to move forward with do not track legislation without further study, any privacy policy generally, or a do not track policy specifically, whether adopted through industry best practice or government directive, should incorporate two principles. First, it should be focused on the kind of personally identifiable information that raises privacy concerns. And second, it must be applied in the same way with respect to all entities operating in the internet ecosystem. Allowing some businesses to track individuals while precluding others from doing so will lead to consumer confusion. Consumers would be better served by a single standard applied uniformly, based on the data being collected and how it will be used. Regulation that disfavors one technology or business model would also deter entry, thwart innovation, and limit competition in the advertising marketplace. We at Time Warner Cable look forward to working with you on these very important issues. Thank you again for the opportunity to appear before you today. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Gilman. Our next witness, Eben Moglen, Legal Advisor, Diaspora, Professor of Law, Columbia University, Founding Director, Software Freedom Law Center. Mr. Moglen.
Thank you, Chairman Rush, Ranking Member Whitfield, Mr. Space, other members of the subcommittee. I very much appreciate the invitation to testify, and I would like to express my particular gratitude for the committee's strong respect for free speech in the legislative process. I think it would be useful to begin with a technical clarification. The receipt of advertising on the web is already completely optional. I receive no advertisements in my browser, on my laptop, or on my mobile devices. any member of the committee or any member of the listening audience on C-SPAN using the Firefox browser could search briefly for AdBlock Plus and discover that advertising is already optional to receive entirely, whether it is targeted advertising or non-targeted advertising. The apparent connection made in the course of this discussion between the economics of the advertising business and whether surveillance ought to be authorized or acceptable on the web therefore escapes me. It is already possible for anyone wishing to receive no advertising to do so. Civilization has not collapsed. The distinguished businesses represented here are still in business, and I believe there is no justification for the conclusion that legitimate control of surveillance on the web in the public interest would have any effect on the economics of the situation, since a blanket ban on receipt of advertising by individual consumers is already fully implemented and available at no charge. I also believe that the concept of tracking is perhaps a part of the general mystification in which consumers find themselves. We should, I think, be more clear with consumers who do not have our level of interest in or expertise in these questions if we simply pointed out that the internet has become a very highly surveilled locale relative to all previous social environments. As Mr. Markey pointed out earlier this afternoon in his questioning, we already have a world in which more than half a billion people live all of their social lives online inside a service provider structure, which puts everything they do, everything they say to one another, every photograph they post, every piece of information they distribute about their social lives in one great big database owned by a single for-profit business, which Mr. Markey named. I think we ought, therefore, to conclude that the idea of do not track, which really ought to be described to the public whose interests we are protecting as do not surveil, is a problem more serious and more comprehensive than the problem of addressing behavioral advertising, which is merely one wrinkle in a rapidly changing technical environment, as others have noted. The problem we really face is the problem of identifying the level of surveillance of human beings in their daily activities, the online oxygen that Mr. Markey referred to, how much surveillance is socially tolerable. Never mind whether it is for profit or for the protection of people from wrongdoing of one kind or another, how much are we prepared to abandon our traditional human understanding that what we do when we read, when we speak to our friends, when we go about our social lives is nobody's business except the business of the people with whom we choose to share? Many technologies, including technologies being developed by my client base, the client base of nonprofit entities who make software for everyone to share freely and at no cost, many technologies under development would allow us to achieve the enormous benefits of the web we know now, along with many other benefits of the web we will still enjoy with minimal levels of surveillance. That will undoubtedly bring significant economic change, as the web itself has brought economic change during the last 8,000 days, which is the total life of the web. In the next 8,000 days, we can decide whether what we want is all the benefits of social networking and all of the benefits of online culture with comprehensive spying going on all the time, or without comprehensive spying going on all the time. As public servants, all of us, I think our role is to arrange to have as little spying as we can. I do not think that is an obligation we can trade off against any other, because I think it reaches directly to the heart of what constitutional freedom is. In my judgment, what we require is a comprehensive National Privacy Policy Act, in which Congress does what Congress does best, set large general societal goals and empower all federal agencies in the conduct of their activities to achieve those goals. The National Environmental Policy Act has, within one generation, done enormous amounts to clean our water, our air, and our environment because of Congress's wisdom in the declaration of broad general principles for the protection of the public interest. Privacy online is the single largest environmental issue in the online world, and it should be addressed with the same degree of seriousness and comprehensiveness with which the physical environment was addressed by Congress one generation ago. Businesses will naturally regard such regulation as burdensome, and that's not a big deal. We must have a clean environment to live in, and we must have a clean online environment that protects our freedom. Our principles acknowledged, there will be plenty of money for everybody to earn. But without our principles acknowledged, we will buy our convenience with our freedom, and that is far too high a price to pay. Thank you for your time. I'm happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Dr. Moglen. Our final panelist, Mr. Daniel Castro, Senior Analyst, Information Technology and Innovation Foundation.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you. I would like to talk with you about why a government-mandated Do Not Track program would be a mistake. If widely adopted, this type of mandate would significantly harm the current funding mechanism for the internet ecosystem, resulting in less free content and fewer free services online. In addition, it would be costly to implement, difficult to enforce, and result in more intrusive and less relevant advertising for consumers. First, it's important to understand that the internet ecosystem is a significant source of economic activity in the United States, accounting for approximately $300 billion, or roughly 2% of GDP, and online advertising is the fuel powering this economic dynamo. Online advertising has grown dramatically over the past decade. As of 2009, the online advertising market was about $23 billion in the United States, and analysts predict that of the $600 billion spent globally on advertising each year, an increasingly larger share of this will go to the online sector. Many of the websites that millions of Americans use daily for work and play would not be around today without advertising. Of the top five most popular websites in the United States, Google, Facebook, Yahoo, YouTube, all of these use advertising almost exclusively to support their products and services, and number five on that list, Amazon.com, uses it to supplement theirs. Targeted ads represent a growing proportion of online ads on these websites. Targeted ads are a benefit to consumers who get more utility from these ads. The percent of users that actually click on an ad are as much as 670% higher for targeted ads than non-targeted ads. And advertisers are willing to pay more to reach their desired audience. Advertising rates are almost three times higher for these targeted ads. Targeted advertising does not involve selling data about users. These websites match ads provided by advertisers to users based on their interest, often without even using any personally identifiable information. I want to emphasize that the impact of policy changes for online privacy can be profound. There was a study by professors at MIT and the University of Toronto on the impact of the EU's privacy directive. The directive limits the ability of advertisers to collect and use information about consumers for targeted advertising. The study found that in Europe, the privacy directive resulted in an average reduction in effectiveness of online ads by approximately 65%. Similar limits on targeted advertising in the United States, especially through a Do Not Track proposal, would be even more harmful. Not only would it eliminate the billions of dollars that targeted advertising pumps into the internet economy, it would stunt the huge potential growth and innovation for new content and services that would come with more of these higher value ads. Do Not Track would also be costly to implement and difficult to enforce. The most popular proposal right now on how Congress or FTC or anyone else can mandate a Do Not Track mechanism is through a modification of the HTTP header. Such a change would require substantial retooling of existing websites, web browsers, and other related software and devices, the cost of which, of course, would ultimately be borne by consumers. In addition, the proposal leaves much ambiguity about what does or does not constitute tracking. Do Not Track may allow sites which have large databases of user information to continue to provide targeted advertising, but would hurt the ability of smaller publishers who rely on third-party ad networks to deliver personalized ads. It may also not apply to other emerging forms of online advertising, such as deep packet inspection. Congress should be careful not to devise policies around a particular business model that would end up hurting some businesses while helping others. It should also not forget that consumers today already have many tools to protect their privacy online. Finally, do not track would result in more intrusive and less relevant advertising for consumers. Do not track, of course, doesn't actually stop online advertising. It only limits the ability of ad networks to deliver ads that a user might actually want. Users who opt out of tracking would receive more, not less, unwanted advertising. In addition, advertisers would likely resort to overlay and pop-up ads, which users may find annoying but are actually more effective at getting their attention. The reason for this is that those small text-based ads are significantly less effective unless they can be tailored to a user's interest. If Do Not Track were widely implemented, another option, of course, is that websites may simply choose to block users who do not allow tracking. In short, privacy is important, but it must be balanced against competing goals, including usability, cost, future innovation, and consumer benefits. A Do Not Track requirement would do more harm than good, and for that reason, I urge the federal government to not go forward with this approach. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. That's our final panelist, and now members will be permitted to ask questions. And I would ask the chairman of this committee, Mr. Rush, if he intends to use his time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And before I ask the question, let me also join in with previous commentary from members of the subcommittee and thanking you for your outstanding service to this subcommittee. You have been a very valuable part of this process that we are now engaged in and have been engaged in. And I certainly have always welcomed your friendship and your leadership, your insight, and your commitment to the affairs of the American people. So congratulations on an outstanding job that you've done. And I do have just maybe a couple of questions that I want to ask a couple of the panelists. On October the 4th, 2010, the Council of Better Bureau, Business Bureaus, along with a group of nations, of our nation's largest media and marketing trade organizations, announced their self-regulatory principles for online behavioral advertising. They also launched an industry-wide advertising option icon, which was to be displayed on web pages that collect and use information for behavioral advertising, and released a beta version of the self-regulatory program's consumer opt-out page. Now, I got to ask Ms. Grant and Ms. Gilliam, Mr. Pasqua, and Mr. Castro, I'm going to ask you two questions, and you can take your time to answer these questions. Have you had the opportunity to review the new consumer opt-out platform and tool, which is part of the Advertising Digital Alliance that was released on the said date? And the second question is, in its current configuration, what are some of the consumer opt-out platform's limitations? What are the limitations of the opt-out platform? Ms. Grant, I'll start with you, and we'll just go down the line.
I have read the principles and the explanation for them for this new program actually several times because it's extremely complicated. It was supposed to be actually launched in July. I don't believe that it's really functioning yet at this point, so I don't think that we can tell much about how it's going to work. But one thing that troubled me was that there were many different options that companies had for how, how they would explain to consumers what they were doing with their information, who was responsible in the chain of companies for doing this, where consumers would go to opt out, whether to a central website that some companies, but not all companies, would use, or to individual companies' websites. I found the whole thing very potentially burdensome for consumers, and I don't think that it's the one-stop shopping easy mechanism that we're looking for.
Ms. Pascoe?
Yes, I did read it, but it was some time ago. I will tell you that we applaud the initiative that they took. The issue is complex, and I think it's early days. It's too soon to actually judge the effectiveness. I think a lot of the complexity is that many of the participants have very different businesses and systems, and they are trying to figure out the best way to do this, and no one today knows the best solution. So the fact that they are trying, I think, is heading in the right direction. I'd also, you asked about limitations. I think it's time, it's consumer education, and it is applying many of these best practices and really learning from them. So it's just time at this point that's the limitation.
Ms. Castro.
Thank you. Yes, I have had a chance to review it. I would say, you know, the limitations is that obviously it's in its nascent stages, but when you look at it, you know, this is certainly an iterative process, as all technology improvements are. And if you see the progress they've made in the past 6 months to a year to 5 years, I think, you know, it's very good. One thing that I think is important when you evaluate these solutions, you know, they don't have to necessarily come up with the best solution. They just have to have a platform that other people can apply a good solution to. And that's, in that sense, they are making a lot of progress. And the other main limitation, though, that I see is that this is obviously only one type of advertising, display advertising on websites. You know, we need to look broadly at creating a fair platform so that all types of online advertising can be competitive.
Ms. Grant, I got another one for you. The CFA has said before that, quote, online opt-out should be as well known and as easy as a do not call list, end of quote, and that a do not track list should be aimed at preventing tracking for, quote, advertising purposes. Can you be more specific in terms of what you mean by advertising purpose? Can you be more precise about it? What are the uses of these online tracking tools and technologies would be permitted and they don't fall into, quote, unquote, advertising purposes?
Well, we've heard today that there are already some solutions out there for consumers. It's not clear how widely known they are. And in some cases, they're things that consumers have to pay for to protect their privacy. It is a challenge whenever you're educating consumers. You have to have very simple central messages to give them. And you have to have very practical, easy things for them to do. Right now, if I was advising a consumer about how to avoid online tracking, I wouldn't be able to give that person very easy, practical advice about what to do, because there's not one easy to do thing, as we are advocating with a do not track mechanism. There are various things out there that have their pros and cons, all of which people have to download or take various steps to do, not as easy as flipping the switch that we envision on one's browser with a do not track mechanism.
Would you take a stab at that from your perspective in terms of what is, would you more precisely define advertising purposes?
Can you actually rephrase the question, because I'd like to make sure I...
Let's try to define, quote, advertising purposes with a little bit more precision. What other uses of these online tracking tools and technologies would be permitted as not falling into, quote, advertising purposes?
You're asking what would not be considered advertising use?
more precise definition of what an advertising purpose,
would be. I'm not a lawyer, so trying to actually draft that language is challenging. I think it's worth a deep discussion. Today, the advertising industry is a large industry, $250 billion. It encompasses communication with consumers through direct mail, through advertising in terms of display advertising. And the information that's often used to inform those campaigns is information that is, you know, can cover purchase information, and it can cover interests that they know about that individual, publicly available information about their college education, their level of education, their income. So to me, the information that might be needed to be used is broad, but most, if not all, major advertising initiatives today do not actually need to use personally identifiable information to deliver marketing messages on the web. So I don't know if that addresses it, but it's a lot of blended information depending on the business.
Can I just add, because I may not have understood your question properly, that beyond the demographic information that is often used in advertising to target it to certain markets, increasingly we're seeing more sensitive kinds of information used, health information and other information, to do exactly what we've heard described, to personalize the advertising. And there are great concerns about that. There may be some people who are not troubled by that, but we know that there are a lot of other people who are, and that those people need an easy-to-use tool to prevent that kind of information from being collected if they don't wish it to be.
Mr. Chairman, may I comment? The purpose of advertisers is to collect information concerning the capabilities and intentions of the potential buyer and to affect that buyer's behavior. Oddly enough, those three points, collection of information about capabilities and intentions for the purpose of affecting behavior, is also the definition of what intelligence services do. There is, in fact, no practicable distinction between the public activity we call collecting intelligence and the private activity we call targeting advertising. They are both spying. The purpose of spying has got to be one which the public would find in its advantage, and not merely in the advantage of the institution performing the spying. We do that with respect to public intelligence services because they're under democratic control. We don't do that with respect to advertisers. They are under nobody's control but their own unless they are regulated. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you also for allowing me the opportunity to chair this hearing. The seat is much more comfortable than I imagined. Chair recognizes Ranking Member Whitfield from Kentucky.
Mr. Castro, you just heard Dr. Moglen's comment about advertising, and I was just curious, would you have any comment to what he just said?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, I think it's actually inaccurate. Spying is very different. Spying, you know what somebody is doing very specifically. It's identifiable. It's implied that it's harmful. In this case, what's happening for most of targeted advertising, most of the collection and use of information online, and you know, when we're talking about this problem, 95% of everything that we talk about is things that most people are comfortable with. It's this kind of 5% gray area that's the exception. But overall, there's a lot of good things that are being done with this data and good things that are helpful to consumers. Data is collected and used so that websites are more accessible, more usable. They're displaying more accurate information. Information is collected so that search engine rankings can be improved. Data is collected, to do targeted advertising. And all of these things help users. I don't think most consumers would consider that they're spied on when they're given something that they want.
Would you like to respond to that anyway, Ms. Moglen?
Well, it seems to me that it heightens again the point that thinking about targeted advertising in isolation is probably not a good idea. But if Mr. Castro is correct, we could test it with a very simple regulatory approach, which would simply require businesses to disclose to consumers on request everything the business knows about them and what they've done with it. Then we will find out whether people are comfortable with what actually happens as opposed to what they can see. Online advertising firms are very secretive in their nature. I don't compare them lightly to intelligence services. They both protect very jealously their methods of collection of information and analysis, and they both protect very jealously what they do with the information that they have. I think if Mr. Castro is correct that what is actually going on would be acceptable to consumers, then there ought to be no objection to regulation that would require consumers to have the power to get exact information about what is known about them and what is done with what is known.
Yes.
Sure, I'd like to respond to that. Of course, you know, the issue that we're talking about today and the broader issue with online tracking and implementing Do Not Track is there's lots of cost involved. So the question is always, is the cost necessary and appropriate? I do absolutely agree that, you know, broadly speaking, we do want government to look out for consumers' privacy rights. One way of doing this is looking specifically at harms. What harms are out there and how can we prevent harms from occurring? Because it doesn't matter to the consumer how someone got data about them. They care if something bad happens to them. They care if someone's discriminating against them or their information is being used in a harmful way. And so I think that's a very appropriate way that Congress can address these kind of privacy concerns that are out there.
Okay, and the ranking member had to step out, so I'll reserve his 2 minutes and 13 seconds. And that leaves me. I do have some questions I'd like to ask. Dr. Moglen, actually, you said something during your response to one of the questions I think asked by Chairman Rush. And while you equated the act of surveillance or tracking to spying, I'm not sure I'd agree with that, but you did say something that I think is really gets to the heart of the matter, and that is who benefits from it. And I've heard testimony today from various people that not only does the advertiser or the digital company that's engaging in the tracking benefit, but there's some suggestion that consumers benefit as well. Specifically, not just in terms of convenience, but it allows, for example, low-income consumers easier access because of cheaper costs. Perhaps the argument could be made that it could allow telecommunication companies the flexibility of extending or expanding their networks to serve underserved and unserved areas. And I'm curious, I'm going to ask Mr. Castro whether you have any quantifiable, measurable data that would provide us with details on how a tracking legislation or an overall blanket prohibition would affect the business model within the industry. And then I'm going to ask you, Ms. Grant, the extent to which you're concerned about the economic consequences of legislative action that might prohibit this kind of activity as it relates to the business model of the telecom companies and their ability then to reach and provide services to low-income and rural or unserved customers.
Yeah, so, you know, you know, would this affect the industry? You know, certainly when you look at the numbers, there's two numbers you have to look at. One is how much is being spent now, and then what the trends are, so how much will be spent in the future. There have been studies on, of course, the effectiveness of online advertising and the impact of regulations, and I pointed to the study to Toronto that looked at the impact of the European Privacy Directive. And that study did find a loss in effectiveness, and what they did as the next step was they said, you know, what would that impact be if advertisers changed their spending in direct correlation to the effectiveness of the ad, which is, you know, a very logical thing. So they could either increase their spending, you know, double the number of ads and get the same effectiveness, or decrease it in line. So if they decreased it, I think this was applied to the U.S. economy, if it was decreased, it would be something like a loss of revenue of about $5 billion.
$5 billion.
It was from around, I can pull out the number in a minute if you'd like the exact. It was over $5 billion.
Whose estimate was that?
This was Tucker and Goldfarb from University of Toronto and MIT.
Who commissioned this study, or was it an academic?
It was an academic study.
Ms. Grant, having heard those numbers, $5 billion is a lot of money, and not just conceivably, but in all probability, might affect the ability of low to middle income consumers to obtain access, and again, underserved or unserved consumers to obtain access. What's your response to that, those monetary concerns?
Well, first of all, if I understand correctly, this was a study of the EU privacy directive, so I don't think that it's exactly on point. I don't know what the impact of do not track would be on telecom companies, but I would like to say a few things that I think would be helpful here. One is that we're not talking about no advertising. There are consumers who might not avail themselves of do not track, so would continue to receive tailored advertising. There are consumers who now and in the future will continue to get contextual advertising, which is based on what they're looking at the time on the internet and doesn't involve following them around and compiling a dossier of what they do and who they talk to. Consumers find information on the internet about the products and services that they want in other ways as well. They do it using search engines. They do it using price comparison websites. So there are lots of ways that people find what they're looking for online, and behavioral advertising is one part of this, but it's certainly not the main or only part, and I don't think that doing away with it will have a, or not doing away with it, but giving consumers control over whether they want to be tracked or not will create a great economic upheaval or turn the internet dark overnight. I'm sure that the Federal Trade Commission wouldn't be supporting the concept of a do not track mechanism if it felt that it would have that effect either. We're all very concerned about the economy and making sure that it's strong and that e-commerce continues to grow, but we don't want to sacrifice consumers' privacy. We don't let companies do whatever they want just because it's profitable. I'm sure that bombarding consumers with telemarketing calls was probably effective, even though a lot of people didn't like it. It made money, but we drew the line. We drew the line in terms of time of day that telemarketers could call consumers, that they couldn't call with an annoying frequency, and then we gave consumers a tool to actually use to reduce unwanted telemarketing if they chose, and that's the kind of thing that we're talking about here.
Thank you, Ms. Grant.
And may I comment, Mr. Smith?
Yeah, in one moment, Dr. Moglen, I am going to call on you to comment, but I would like to know from Ms. Gilman whether Time Warner, for example, can quantify and give us some indication as to how this affects your business model and your ability to provide cable services to consumers at current pricing. Have you done studies? Is there any measurable data that we can look at?
We've not done a study that looked at that specifically, but I can speak to the fact that we need to innovate every day to adapt to consumer interests, consumer needs. They look to us to make improvements to our service every day. And in this debate being a very important debate, the risk one runs is that there are unintended consequences of a do not track policy, in that it prevents companies like ours from innovating. I'd also like to add, though, that the vibrancy of the internet is extremely important as well. and what should be explored around this debate and discussion is really the unintended consequences for the smaller content providers and service providers, the small businesses in and around this ecosystem. The smaller the website, the smaller the audience, the more challenging times they have selling contextual advertising. So they do not have a large enough audience. So we really want to encourage innovation in the internet ecosystem, and we want new players entering, and we want to make sure that any discussion around this debate does not prevent that from happening.
Okay, Dr. Moglen, you have the last word.
I very much doubt, Mr. Chairman, that there is any person in this room whose life has not been altered by Wikipedia, which has provided opportunities for underserved populations of the kinds that you were talking about to conduct research and to learn at a level which is otherwise inaccessible to them. Wikipedia is unsupported by advertising, and of the 100 most visited sites on the net studied by the Wall Street Journal in the series previously referred to, it was the only one of the 100 not in any way surveilling or tracking its users. I think, once again, that the attempt to connect the advertising business model to the importance of vibrant content on the net, or life-changing possibilities of expansion of access to underserved populations, is poppycock.
Okay, with that, the chairman have any additional questions?
Chairman, in the interest of time, I'm going to just pass because I think that you and the other members of this panel have been here for quite some time, and I would feel as though I was taking advantage of my freshness, my fresh legs, if I would ask another question. So I'm going to pass.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Ranking Member Whitfield.
How do you spell poppycock?
Yeah, how do you spell poppycock,
Professor? I'll modify my remarks to spell it out.
All right, with that, this hearing is adjourned.
Coming up on January 2nd, C-SPAN's new documentary, The Supreme Court, Home to America's Highest Court. See inside the historic building and the beautiful places only available to the justices and their staff.